Yes, I heard those. No, no, I have to be I'll be your witness.
So what are we doing? Which one are we doing? 41 and 42? And 43, right?
Thank you.
What? No, no, no.
Thank you.
We're doing next 41, 43, 43?
Going back to
okay.
42. So 7:49, we're back in session. Item number 42, discussion and action regarding claims submitted by Ralph Duran for damage to or taking of real and personal property.
Why are you guys listening to me?
Well, you picked up your hand.
And difficult questions here? Let me see. I didn't bring my glasses. Oh, okay. I'd like to make the motion to authorize and direct the city attorney to tender the property damage claim by Mr. Ralph Duran to
information.
Yeah. Okay. Eagles Enterprise Inc. for indemnity and to make a claim on their performance bond and to deny the platting portion of his claim.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Because I have a personal claim to this, I'm abstaining, and I will file an affidavit tomorrow morning.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Iván Colón Villalobos?
Yes.
Item number 43, consultation with legal counsel regarding legal issues regarding Samuel Leone, complainant versus the City of Socorro, respondent EEOC number 453-2017-00914.
With respect to item number 43, I will make the motion to approve the offer of settlement as we discussed with counsel in closed session.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
No, for the reason is that people have a tendency to keep suing the city of Socorro, and I think that we need to put our foot down and say no more, because that costs taxpayers. If I believe that if we continue on this road, we'll never change that mentality.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
It is because we are trying to save the taxpayers' money that we have to pursue this road. Yes.
Ivan Colombia Lopez.
And unfortunately, I like to say no, but I agree with Mr. Perez. In order to save money for the city, unfortunately, it's a yes.
Moving on to consent agenda, do we have a motion?
Motion to approve consent agenda.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia Lobos?
Yes.
Item number 8, introduction, first reading, and calling for a public hearing of an ordinance amending section 42-99 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Socorro, Texas, to restrict the commercial vehicle truck route on North Nevarez Road from accessing Alameda Avenue from North Nevarez Road and vice versa. Mr. Duran?
I make a motion to approve for discussion. The, this is a public hearing.
Is it public hearing?
That's right.
It's not a public,
oh,
it's an introduction.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have a second?
So, did you complete your motion?
No, I didn't.
No.
Let me complete it. I'd like to make a motion calling for a public hearing on an ordinance amending section 49-99 of the code. Of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Socorro, Texas, to restrict the commercial vehicle truck route on North Nevarez Road from accessing Alameda Avenue from North Nevarez and North Nevarez Road and vice versa.
Second.
No relation.
I was going to ask
that. Any specific questions, or would you like a quick background on this?
If and when we're restricting, correct?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Okay, my whole thing is that there's been some talks about connecting Nevarez to North Loop. So in the future, we're gonna have to reamend this if that street gets widened, correct?
That is in your powers to do that, yes, sir.
Okay, that's all I wanted to know.
Ms. Yelvos?
Can you put it up on? Do you have? If you can. Oh, can he?
Yeah.
And I'm doing this so everybody knows what's going on here.
Sure.
Number one, and number two. I see we're trying to block that. Last night I was looking on it, at it on my computer. I see there's just maybe one other road for that the residents can. The trucks are going to be able to use. So what you're highlighting is how they're going to be coming out of the location where they're stationed and coming out on the blue side. The blue side is what's going to be blocked.
To clarify, actually, this shows all of North Nevarez Road within the city of Socorro, from Alameda all the way up north to the city limits, which will eventually goes to Englewood Road. So that shows the entire road. What we're looking at restricting is basically restriction of commercial vehicular traffic in this portion of North Nevada's road.
That's the residential area.
That is correct, sir. So essentially, any commercial vehicle truck would have to access Nevada's off of Englewood, outside of the city limits from El Paso.
And I'm sorry, in terms of that area, Nevarez, for some reason, elevates. and there's a stretch that's below Nevada's actually, the neighborhood there. So to me, that's dangerous for truck traffic because mm-hmm. God forbid something happens with a truck. I mean, there is a real possibility of there being an accident there.
That is correct, sir.
Mr. Duran?
I brought this item up because those people from the railroad tracks back this way, there's speed bumps, and when those trucks hit those speed bumps, it vibrates the houses really bad. I was visiting with some people, and some trucks were going by. The houses are they're basically being cracked, and there's no reason for having it. They can access all of those businesses through Inglewood. They don't need it. It's shorter through there, but because, like you say, there is, and when they put those speed bumps in, it just made it that much worse. And I don't see that it's going to impede anybody's business, but it will protect those people's homes from further damage by putting those restrictions for not having any commercial traffic from the railroad tracks back to Alameda.
Ms. Yelavos?
And I have a couple of questions. How are these 18-wheelers or truck drivers going to access the coming in and out of the business?
As you can see, Nevada's continues up north from Inglewood, uh-huh. and Inglewood is accessed not only from Alameda this way, but also North Loop this way as well, ma'am.
And so mm-hmm. that it's not going to hurt another residential area by doing this?
This is the only residential area along Nevada's in the city of Socorro. Everything else is zoned either commercial or industrial or agricultural, ma'am.
And so the city of Socorro is going to send out notices to these businesses, put out signs. How are they going to get notified? How are these drivers going to get notified?
Essentially, we would work with our public works department to put up those signs of no heavy traffic signs along North Nevada Street, close to the intersection of Alameda, and on the way down, and on the opposite end as well, to show them that no heavy vehicular traffic allowed in that direction as well.
I'm sorry?
Because this is not a zone change, ma'am. It's basically a general rule, if you will. Public notice is not sent out to the adjacent property owners.
We publish in the newspaper?
Publish within the newspaper, yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry? What was that?
We publish?
We publish in the newspaper.
Well, who reads in the newspaper? But I know, but who understands, you know, when they're reading the public? My question is, do we have, I guess right now I'm hearing we don't have an obligation to let them know you can't. I mean, this is the way they do things, and some of us drive and we might not see the sign because we've been doing it for so long. We don't pay attention. We think we know what the signs are, and then here comes a police officer and gives this poor guy a hefty fine, and you know, two tickets, your license could be, or your company could fire you, your license could be suspended. I guess what I'm trying to say, I know we're protecting our residents, but also our people that are doing business here in Socorro should be notified. Is there anything that we can do to, how many companies are being affected?
Ms. Lopez, I don't know the exact number of actual businesses along North Nevada that will be affected, public notice letter could definitely be something we could send out, just regular mail, to let them know. Just let them know the situation. That's definitely something my department could look into doing, yes, ma'am.
I think that would be best than having all these companies come running to planning and zoning very upset over something that they changed and they didn't get notified. I think we should be a little bit more friendly to everybody that's doing business and lives here. So I hope that's something that we can put in the motion. Or do we have to put it in the motion? Mm-hmm. That's a good idea. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
And Ivan Colom Villalobos.
Yes.
Item number 9, introduction, first reading, and call for a public hearing of an ordinance amending the City of Socorro Master Plan and the proposed rezoning of Lot 7, Block 12, Bejar Estate, Subdivision 11830, Alameda Avenue from C2 General Commercial to M1 Light Industrial.
Make a motion to deny.
Second. Sir, just, what was the intended use for that?
The intended use for the subject property was essentially, pardon me, was essentially to use the property as a storage yard, essentially, sir, where they would park vehicles there temporarily and then move them off when they get sold, sir, essentially.
Thank you.
Ms. Yelos?
Do we know why they weren't using it as intended? Or how long they had been using it other than what it was intended to be used for?
Ms. Villalobos, I don't know the exact amount of time that they've been doing there. We have been working with the property owner about asking him to come in for a zone change for that intended use. That was the only way he could continue the use as he had it as of then. But he did submit his application because this is the only avenue that he could continue to use the property as a storage yard, if you will. And now it's before you for your consideration.
And this is why. What is the reason why? I think you guys denied it, correct? You guys are asking for a denial. Or
the Planning and Zoning Commission recommended denial.
Denial. Do you know why? Other than because it wasn't being used as intended?
No, ma'am. I believe the Planning and Zoning Commission made that motion, essentially stating that by approving this, they could potentially allow for this additional types of those types of uses in an area where they feel it's more residential on this side of Alameda, and that is why they recommended denial.
Alrighty, thank you.
And then what happens is that if I'm correct, these are the kinds of cars that may be damaged or and so they'll hold them for a while, then they'll transport them maybe over the border, and so they have a potential to be done.
Well, this was actually a storage yard. Junkyard is different from this, so these vehicles would have to essentially be somewhat in working condition. Couldn't be like a total vehicle on the property, sir. It's light industrial. For that, they would have needed M2 heavy industrial zoning.
But the reason why I'm saying is because around my area, we've had something like that behind that they were using it. They were using that part of the property to move those cars. But the thing is that depending on how fast they get them out of there, they start becoming an eyesore. Mm-hmm. And so that's the one thing that we're trying to
change. We're trying to change and clean the city, make it look better. Absolutely. Thank you.
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
And Ivan Colom Villalobos.
Yes.
Item number 10, introduction, first reading, and call for a public hearing of an ordinance amending the City of Socorro Master Plan and correcting the zoning designation of lots 2A and 2B, Block 2, La Jolla Subdivision, Replat A, 10507 and 10509, Santa Paula Drive to C1 Light Commercial.
Motion to approve.
Second.
A little bit of background on this, ladies and gentlemen. The two properties shown here on the map, located just south of Beaufort Road, pretty close to what's the early childhood center there on Beaufort Road. The applicants came in, I'm sorry, under the previous director, they came in, they were told that the properties were improperly zoned, and currently one of the properties is a commercial property, the other one is a single family residential. Single-family dwelling, pardon me, currently. Then they were told that they needed to get a zone change after further investigation that we did, it actually does show that they have been zoned commercial C1. So this is just essentially clarifying or correcting that the properties are zoned C1, which would allow the commercial business and the single family home to continue as is, and to amend our master plan as well.
Mr. Perez?
See, what happened is that the owners came to me almost 2 years ago now.
Yes.
And so the problem was that they were told by the previous director that the zone was incorrect. However, they had been paying permit fees and to the city for years. And so we needed to correct that situation. And so this is the best way, because they were in good faith paying their permits and all the and everything that the city required. And so we set up a meeting. I set up a meeting with Ms. Rodarte and one of the owners of the property. It's a husband and wife. And we met with the wife, and we were able to dialogue and get things straightened out. And then this is the process and the result.
And just to add to that, we have multiple businesses operating that way, where the temporary permits were given and they don't have the zoning change. However, with this particular one, is we have a city map way back, and it's colored. It's like a coloring book. And it identifies it that at some point these properties were given a commercial status. However, since we don't have minutes from way back then, there was no way of confirming that. So what I told the resident is we'll take it to council just to make sure that it's official and there's public record of it, that it is commercial. That way, if the administration changes, that person is not, they don't go out to their home and want to rezone again. But she had been paying for the rezoning since 2012, correct. And that money will be refunded back to her.
Yes, it actually has been sent out to our finance department to finalize for reimbursement.
Mr. Rodriguez?
So we're talking about our ex-director, which we were discussing on item 43, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
Ms. De Lobos?
I didn't hear correctly. You said it was a residential home and a daycare?
No, ma'am. It's currently a commercial business, a beauty salon,
oh.
and a single family home, which both are permitted in the C1 zoning district.
It's across from the Escondidos early childhood center. So that's what it is.
Okay. Whatever my other question is, I can't remember. Sorry.
Lenny Rodriguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia López?
Yes.
Item number 11, discussion and action to approve update to physical requirements section of the police officer job description.
Motion to approve for discussion.
Second.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This item was approved on January 22nd. And what we're trying to do with this item is to spell out the physical requirements of a police officer. And if you look at the new requirements or the proposed changes and compare them to the current police officer job description, you'll see it's very different. The current description has three items. And the third one is must withstand vigorous physical demands common to police officer work. Well, with the proposed changes, we're spelling it out. And as if you'd like, I could go down each one, but as you can see, I mean, you spell out the standing for long periods, sitting for long periods, ability to drive motor vehicles, all that is very useful, because then an applicant really understands what is expected, what the physical requirements of the position are. So does anyone have any questions about this?
René Rodriguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia-Lopez?
Yes.
Item number 12, discussion and action to approve update to physical requirements section of sergeant job description.
It's very similar to the last item. And the reason why we also wanted to make the changes to the sergeant's job description is because they also patrol. So they do a lot. They have supervisory duties, yes, but they also patrol the streets. So they have these are the, they're the same physical demands applied to them.
Motion to approve. I'm sorry.
No, and I was going to say this was also approved by the Civil Service Commission on January 22nd.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to make a motion to approve the modifications to the job description of police sergeant.
Second.
Or job descriptions.
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia López.
Yes.
Item number 13, discussion and action to approve amendment to paid time off policy in the City of Socorro's employee handbook.
Motion to approve for discussion.
Second.
Okay, with this item, we're trying to avoid a situation where an employee who is on approved workers' comp leave is at risk of losing accrued leave in excess of 40 hours if, well, so let me backtrack. An employee can only carry 40 hours of accrued leave onto the next fiscal year. So employees who maybe have, let's say 50, 60 hours of accrued leave towards the end of the fiscal year have to use anything in excess of 40 or they will lose it. Well, we actually have a situation with an employee who was on approved workers' comp leave and was unable to use their accrued leave and ended up losing about 20 hours of leave because the employee was not able to use it, okay? That the leave extended towards the end of the fiscal year and the employee had no way to use it and we couldn't pay out on it because if you pay out if you pay out any kind of money to an employee who's on workers' comp, that affects their temporary income benefits. So the only remedy there is to allow employees under these circumstances to carry it over. And the situation is very out of the ordinary. This is not very common. I mean, I think that if it was common, it would have happened a long time ago, but we caught this time, and so we're trying to remedy the situation and avoid, you know, having an employee go through this again. And this was also approved on January 22nd.
And just to add is we can't pay out because that's not part of our policy. We just don't pay out, no matter the circumstance.
That's it.
Okay. That's
Mr. Rodriguez?
I didn't hear that.
We do not pay out leave because it's not a part of our policy. That's not an option for anyone.
So they can't have a nest egg of accrued leave, leave, and then at the end, they'll cash it in.
How many people are affected in the last 3 years?
None.
This is
the first time it happened, and so we want to.
So we're amending our ordinance for one.
Well, no, this we're amending the handbook.
Sorry,
yeah.
For one. No.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
Ivan Colombia López?
Yes.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Item number 15, discussion and action to award bid 17-011 for a pothole patch truck to get Freightliner of El Paso in the amount of $173,882.19.
Motion to approve for discussion.
Second.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. So before you use item to approve the awarding of bid for a patchwork truck that was passed through Council for last budget of the department buying a truck, we got three bids, from Freightliner dealers here locally and one in Austin, and as well as another company from out of town. After the scoring was done, the scores came out to have the local dealer to be the winner of the award. As you can see in your backup, all the specifications and all the pricing criteria are shown, and our recommendation is to award this to the local Freightliner dealer. Yes,
Mayor.
Mr. Rodriguez?
I brought this a while back for this purpose, but are we also hiring the three individuals?
They're already on staff, sir, and
okay,
we are working.
That's all I wanted to know. Thank you.
Ms. Yalamos?
Well, this vehicle is expensive.
Yes.
However, it's your one-stop shop. Do it all except, you know, the manpower. Is that
pretty much, yes, sir.
I noticed it has a sander, just for the public to know. Has a sander,
Yeah, it has actual compact plate. It has a breaker hammer. It has a, so pretty much you eliminate any manual carrying of tack oil, an air compressor, because the machine has all this built into it. And it makes our jobs more professional, quicker, and it allows it for us to better track. This actual truck has a system in it which can actually keep track of how many tons are delivered, and it could be tracked through GIS, through GPS, and through other forms of new technological advances.
So, in essence, the 174,000
plus? Yes, 73,882.83
In essence, it's going to save us money.
In the long run, yes, ma'am.
These trucks, did they tell you how long they last?
Well, the one we have currently, I believe it was purchased a couple of years after the city reactivated. And, I mean, it's still going strong. Not strong. To its full potential, but it's still functional.
Okay. Are we doing anything with that vehicle? Are we keeping it?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes, we're keeping it as a spare. Okay.
Well, all the residents here hope that their potholes are done with, you know, in record time, and yeah, that they're pretty and nice and not falling apart, you know, when that, the water rain comes.
That's the purpose of to stand up.
Mr. Perez?
Just a question. On the, is there a compaction piece to this where it,
yes, sir. We have a compactor plate on the truck itself, and we also have actual roller depending on the size of the patch.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Rob Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia Lopez?
Yes.
Item number 16, discussion and action to approve a lining option for Veterans Park.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Good evening, again, Mayor and Council members. On this item, I brought up a couple of options for the lighting of the future green space. I know our main goal is to turn go green. As you can see in the backup, there's certain costs associated with those kind of endeavors. I know the electrical company was said not to be a player in this, but then again, due to the amounts that we're talking about, I thought it was prudent to present it to you all and let you go ahead and make that decision. I went with the first proposal, which is the Paso Electric, like I mentioned in the backup. It is a proposed 1,100 watts lights throughout the perimeter of the proposed green area, and it's something like you see right now on Rio Vista Road. These require more or less an $1,800 cost per year. The facilities, the fixtures, and the poles and maintenance are done by the Paso Electric. We only pay services like we do any other type of electrical. In that sense, this is the cheapest and most feasible option. Then again, we go to the solar. I went with a medium range solar option, which is option solar option one. We do have a couple of surplus material from other parks that we have in stock, which are the concrete poles that were used, like the ones in Mauro Rosas, which could fit these type of lamps that we're proposing. We would still have to buy another 12 poles for a cost of $15,000, plus the shipping, which comes down to $19,000 just for the poles themselves. Granted, solar power, it is sufficient, but it doesn't cover as much as running electrical current. So for the 10 proposed 100 watts, we will need 25 fixtures to light up somewhat the same perimeter. Option two on the solar option is like the high-end lamp that's out there. These are something similar to what we're installed in Azcarate, and these run for $58,000 for 20 units. These units, the cost is for the pole, the fixture, and the arm. The fixture itself is $2,000. I mean, these are costs in the long run. I guess the advantage on the solar, you have no wires. I mean, these things are, the battery life estimated is 5 years, and so are the bulbs. So I mean, it's whether you want to see the wires and pay less over a long time, pay more and have a more aesthetically and eco-friendly fixtures up front. And these are kind of the options we want to present in order to see what way we're going to move forward with these with this endeavor, knowing that if we do any of the solar options, it's going to take a big hit from the available budget to do other things.
I'm sorry, is that next part? What, rewind, I didn't hear you correctly.
Yes, ma'am. So pretty much wherever we go, the financial amount is going to impact what we can do with the money that we have allocated for that project. We have currently $65,000, and I mean, if you take 29 or 58,000 out of it, well, then it reduces what we can do further, the walking trails, the benches, the trash cans, I mean, the overall plan. I understand we did get our parks master plan approved today, but you know, searching for grants, it's not a 1 day or 2 day thing, it takes time. So I mean, those are things I would like for you to consider when making a decision on this item.
Mr. Levin?
If on the, with the electric company, what would be the cost for 5 years of operating those lights versus the first solar plan?
Well, pretty much, I mean, we're having almost $2,000 a year. So inside that's 10 grand in 5 years. The maintenance will be taking care of them, like by them, which will include bulbs, installation. We're not getting charged installation of poles because they will remain city, El Paso Electric Company. So if one gets damaged, they will replace them. That's all under the contract that's in the backup. And we'll, in 5 years, let's say all batteries and fixtures lasted 5 years. After 5 years, more or less in bulbs, and a battery pack is $500, and the LED pack is $275. That's just for sake of argument, then all go off on 25 of them. I mean, after 5 years, you're gonna invest another $8,000-$10,000 to keep bring them up. So I mean, it's just initial cost that takes a hit on the solar ones. What we might end up saving in the long run is just the way, it just depends on what way we wanna go to set that standard for any future and existing parks to eventually have one style throughout, because you know, in the long run, that would save on maintenance, that would save on a lot of other things as well.
Ms. Alamos?
So the estimated cost of lighting this Veterans Park would be estimated at $1,884 if we go with the electric company.
Yes, ma'am.
For all 10
fixtures.
Poles.
And we can add up to 12 fixtures more if we need it at a rate of $1,170 per month. That's pretty much what's costing us per month to run one of these.
So in your professional opinion, or in your opinion, you're saying the electric company, if we go option one, the electric company or option one or two of the solar, it would still, it costs more to go solar right now for the equipment, and in 5 years we probably have to replace the battery pack.
In the worst case scenario.
Right.
So I mean, you know, it's like anything. A watch may last you 20 years, you never have a problem with it, or it may last you 2 weeks and have to repair the battery. I mean, it's those kinds of things. I mean, this technology is being brought up because of obvious reasons, you know, electrical costs are rising, things of that nature, aesthetics. But then again, it's not too new, but it's not to the point that it's 100% tested. And also there's a lot of variations.
So the other question I had was, is this the only park we're putting lights at the moment? Or do we have any other parks in the future?
Well, in the future, as in the master plan, it's delineated for all parks and existing.
Already approved, I'm sorry, sir. Already approved.
Yes, sir. Well, this is for the only one at the moment.
I'm just saying, if we were to buy it in bulk, would it cost a lot less, the lighting, for the rest of the parks, than having to do one by one? That would save us a lot of money.
Yes, ma'am. That's right. Like on the option, solar option one, if we buy more than 50, there is a reasonable discount. On the high-end ones, it is a discount, but not to the point. You have to buy more than 100 units. And then it comes down to that, if we're gonna store, let's say, 80 of these lights for 5 years till we get funding to add them to another park, some of these things, I mean, you know, they go to waste being in storages and things like that. So, I mean, it's just,
well,
depends what we want.
Let's try to be, so let's say we have these 12 parks, and we buy it in bulk, and then we vote on in the future of getting them all the lights up, period.
Yes, ma'am.
That would make a lot more sense and save money and use our money for other stuff than having to do one park by one, because that's just going to cost us a lot. That's my opinion.
No, I understand. Just that this is all for the actual funding that's available for this park that was set aside. So, I mean, that would be, I mean, that's a good point to keep in mind.
Thank you.
Make a motion to approve.
Which option?
We already have it.
What option?
Yes, approve option.
The recommendation is that.
Yeah.
Okay, because, we're going to make a motion to approve.
For discussion.
No, I didn't say for discussion, because once you make the motion, it's granted that it's already for discussion.
So what option?
So, staff's recommendation.
Option one?
Is that the staff recommendation, El Paso Electric, or solar?
Oh, that wasn't your?
Well, I left it up to you, but.
Oh, okay. I thought that was yours. When I read it, I thought it was your recommendation.
Well, no, the initiative is, you know, the directive that we received from council was, let's look at the solar options, and that's why we went out there. Cost effectiveness, I don't think we're ready for solar at this time. So we're recommending El Paso Electric. However, the reason we brought those prices is because that's something that council had expressed interest in.
One more thing, I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
On the electric, can you go back and say, look, we're trying to revamp our city parks. I don't know if I should be directing this to you, but to both of you. And we might be buying more electrical poles. You know, can we agree that if we buy them in 2 years or 3 years, that we get a discount?
Well, these are two-year contracts, and this was done. We get this pricing due to the fact that at Chayo Apodaca, we own a transformer. That's why we're getting this lower cost of $11.70 a month. If we were to have to bring in a transformer, more electrical iron, more wire, those things change. Since not about all of our parks, we have those amenities already owned by the city, those prices will change nonetheless.
And I don't think we're posted for that item. Yeah, it was just to discuss the lighting on Veterans Park. But you're more than welcome to place an item on the agenda to direct staff to do that.
Okay.
And just to clarify, it was option one.
No, it's El Paso Electric, solar option one, solar option two. El Paso Electric.
So, it's standard electric.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Val.
El Paso Electric.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Item number 17, discussion and action to award the landscaping maintenance contract to ARE Landscaping Management in the amount of $32,500.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Mayor, council, again, so the department was awarded $80,000 to compromise of a weed squad in order to help the department get ahead on the weed control throughout the city. And along with our city manager, we took the initiative to look at alternative ways to try to maximize these funds and provide a better service for our constituents. So we came up with a plan of going out to get bids for a landscaping management company to take care of a couple of areas that are delineated in the background. And these were the actual numbers that we came up with, as well as the scores and the rankings. So that's why this department is recommending the award of this bid to ARE Landscaping Management in the sum of $32,500. The actual bid is close to $48,000 due to it being not the full year. It's being prorated for the rest of the fiscal year, which comes down to the $32,500. These services will maintain our main roads, which are all vehicle tanks from North Loop to Alameda, which will include the medians. It will include Moon Road from Alameda to North Loop. It will include Rio Vista from Thunder Road all the way to Buford, next to Escondrias. It will include Horizon from Alameda to North Loop, and Passmore from Alameda to Socorro Road. This will include the medians, any shoulder work, and any, the only one that would actually get broom or swept will be Horizon Boulevard due to the fact that it has curbing. It will also include the cleanup of five of our parks, which will be Mauro Rosas, Rio Vista, Cougar Park,
Bulldog,
and these will be weekly services. They will do trimming, taking out the trash, and mowing the large areas of grass where there's any. It will also include all of our facilities, which will include Chayo Polaca Community Center, Rio Vista Community Center, the Court Administration Building, the Police Department headquarters, as well as their offices, Vineyard, and I think that's it.
Just to clarify.
Yes.
So that 32.5 is a prorated amount for
yes.
the remainder of the year.
Yes, that's the remainder 7 months.
So then we would have to go go for bid.
For the fall, yes, or yes.
Correct, and right now it's just an initiative since we started our systematic approach back in 2016. So November of 2017, we sat down and said, okay, what can we do different? Because we're not making big of an impact that we want. We were given 80,000 for the weed squad, but we thought, okay, if we receive help in the higher end roads, that'll alleviate that'll alleviate the workload to the public works staff, so they're able to beat the weeds.
Okay. Thank you.
At the summertime, so. But then next year we'll see if that worked or not worked.
I'm sorry,
Ms. Delos.
Didn't we vote on this already last? What did we vote on the last meeting?
No, they gave you a presentation.
It was a presentation
of the
summer.
Oh. Okay.
It was just a presentation.
Thank you.
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia López.
Yes.
Item number 18, discussion and action on the proposed conditional use permit for an automotive body shop on tract 4C1A, block 3, Socorro Grant, 896 Horizon Boulevard.
Make a motion to approve.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Next case, ladies and gentlemen, is a proposed conditional use permit to allow the use of an automotive body shop on the subject property located at 896 Horizon Boulevard, as shown here, highlighted here. Subject property is zoned C2, has been zoned C2 general commercial since 2000, and the subject property is utilized for multiple businesses, barbershop, automotive sales, tax preparations and so on and so forth. So this would be there are currently totally five businesses on the property. There have been six, they've been approved for six in the past, so this would be the sixth business on the property with the automotive body shop. The Planning and Zoning Commission did recommend approval for the proposed conditional use permit. There were concerns at that meeting about the smell of paint and fumes in the area and that this was possibly the property or the business that was doing so. Staff did go out there and investigate the subject property. The applicant does have an actual paint booth that meets all standards, meeting all standards for what is a paint booth, with the exhaust, meeting all exhaust requirements for a paint booth and so forth like that. So unfortunately, we are aware of the situation in the area, so it's potentially somewhere else that is coming from, but currently the subject property does meet the requirements of having an enclosed paint booth for an auto body shop. So that concern should essentially be taken care of with this. But with that, the Planning and Zoning Commission did recommend approval for the proposed conditional use permit.
Ms. Elvas?
Is this I know there's other businesses. Is this a new business or was it something else before?
Beforehand, I could answer that. beforehand, this was a thrift store, a secondhand store, if you will, and now it's being replaced. That portion of the building is being replaced with the auto body shop.
Thank you.
Sir.
Sir.
You cannot speak, sir. We don't have any speakers on this item?
No, we don't.
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
Ivan Colombia López.
Yes.
Item number 19, discussion and action for approval of pool subdivision replat D, being a replat of lot 23, block 4, pool subdivision, Socorro, Texas, 10966 Oden Drive.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Mr. Perez?
If I may ask or make a suggestion, on the backup information, and I think I requested this before, I'd like to see a separate staff recommendation because the Planning and Zoning Commission by definition is not part of the staff. And so I would like to see what you all have to say and what the commission says.
Yes, Mr. Perez, I apologize. I actually did put that on the East Lake. I don't know if you saw that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just forgot to put it on this one. But to clarify, staff did recommend approval for this replat, essentially is what it is. It is a proposed subdivision of an existing about 21,780 square foot lot into two new lots, each one over 10,000 square feet, meeting the minimum 10,000 square foot lot size requirement of the existing R1 zoning district. Essentially, as you can see there by the aerial, one lot will contain the existing home, the other lot will be vacant, would be and would allow for an additional, well, a new home to be built on that new lot. Yes, ma'am.
I guess you answered my question. So it's to build another future home, and that's it. Not a duplex, not a, just a future home.
Ms. Villalobos, the subject property is zone R1, so all they can have is a single family home on there, accessory structure, shade structure, but that's it, ma'am. That is correct. The zone change would be required if additional homes would be wanted on that property.
Thank you.
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
Ivan Colombia López.
Yes.
Item number 21, discussion and action on authorizing the mayor to sign an interlocal agreement between the City of Socorro and Camino Real Regional Mobility Authority to establish the duties and responsibilities of the City of Socorro, Texas Department of Transportation and the CRRMA.
Motion to approve.
Second.
I'll take a crack at it here. This is essentially just the finalized agreement, or the agreement that needs to be finalized and signed by the mayor, which is essentially the final obligation that the City of Socorro has to pay towards what was the construction of Nuevo Waco tanks, which is the amount of, I believe it's 41,000, let me get you the exact amount, pardon me.
Okay, and what happened with this, there was a change on the median. The property owner wanted the median to be changed at his own cost. However, because it's through the RMA and we're getting federal funding, they paid a check to the city. Now the city just pays the developer.
Correct.
For the change. But we already have the check here, but we have to sign the
right, change the agreement order. Needs the to be signed order. For the change order to be finalized, and we can pay the funds as needed.
How much was that check for?
41,652.
Yes, ma'am.
That's what the constituent paid?
Correct, the property owner.
The property owner.
Or the property owner, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so the property owner down south of the street wanted to make it a little bit more beautiful than the rest. So he copped up some pretty money. So.
No, I think he wanted entrance to
his
entrance. Property.
Yeah, he wanted pretty.
For future commercial business.
Okay. Alrighty, thank
so.
You.
It's no cost to us anyway.
That's very
René Rodríguez.
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Perez.
Aye.
Ivan Colombia López.
Yes.
Item number 22, public hearing on written charge to remove Christian Guzman as a member of the Board of Adjustment for the City of Socorro, Texas.
Motion to
Second.
Public hearing. 841. Public hearing is now open.
Oh, I apologize.
842, public hearing is now closed. Item number 23, discussion and action on approval to remove Christian Guzman as a member of the Board of Adjustments for the City of Socorro, Texas.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez?
Yes.
Ralph Turan?
Yes.
Victor Pérez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colom Villalobos is absent.
Item number 24, discussion and action to approve Mayor Elia Garcia and Representative-at-Large René Rodríguez to attend the Regional 4 TML Quarterly Meeting Friday, February 2nd, 2018 in Alpine, Texas, as opposed to January 26, 2018, as previously approved.
Motion to approve.
Second.
I just want to add, Mayor.
Mr. Rodríguez?
I just want to add that this one was previously between, last week, but, the president couldn't attend, and he can't attend on this one as well, so they just pushed the date. That's what we brought to the council, because we weren't going on the date that we was approved, so it's actually tomorrow. Cut it in time.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez?
Yes.
Ralph Turan?
Yes.
Victor Pérez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colom Villalobos is absent.
Item number 25, discussion and action on a resolution authorizing the City of Socorro to submit a grant application to the Office of the Governor Criminal Justice Division's Body Worn Camera Program.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. My name is Alejandra Valadez, and I'm the interim grants coordinator for the city. This is a grant opportunity through the Office of the Governors, and our chief has requested the submission of the grant for 30 body worn cameras. We do have a letter of support from the district attorney, so that's it. For this grant, there are no, there's a 20% match for this grant.
Call question?
No?
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez?
Yes.
Ralph Turan?
Yes.
Victor Pérez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colom Villalobos is absent.
Item number 26, discussion and action on a resolution authorizing the City of Socorro to submit a grant application to the Office of the Governor Homeland Security Division State Homeland Security Program Regular Projects Grant.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, so the State Homeland Security Program funds, police departments for programs that prevent and protect from terrorist attacks. So our police chief has requested some funding for, enhancing the capability at our emergency operations centers, and also for police training, so that's what the funds will be requested for. For this grant, there is no match, so we're good on that.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevárez?
Yes.
Ralph Turan?
Yes.
Victor Pérez?
Aye.
Ivan Colom Villalobos?
Yes. I read it.
Item number 27, discussion and action on a resolution authorizing the City of Socorro to submit a grant application to the National Recreation and Parks Association 2018 Disney Place Basis Grant.
Motion to approve.
Second.
For this grant, the grant is designed to create play spaces where, people of various generations can interact, so children and adults and seniors. Speaking to the Recreation Parks Director, it was requested that we submit an application for a walking path with, outdoor gym stations, as well as little play nooks for kids to interact while parents are on the outdoor gym equipment. For this grant, there is a 50% match, but the allocation that the city has already done towards the Rio Vista project is enough to cover that match requirement.
Call a question.
René Rodríguez.
Do you have the? Aye.
Cesar Nevárez.
Yes.
Ralph Duran.
Yes.
Victor Pérez.
Aye.
Ivan Colom Villalobos.
Yes.
All I did was call a question.
Oh, okay.
Item number 28, discussion on action to remove Representative at Large René Rodríguez and appoint Mayor Elia García as a board member to the Transportation Policy Board of El Paso Metropolitan Planning Organization.
Motion to approve for discussion.
Second.
This item, I just went ahead and posted the item because as mayor, I would like to go ahead and fulfill the duties of being the leader of this community and taking over in the Metropolitan Planning Organization as well as on the board. I will be joining the other mayors as it is customary that the mayor is the one that takes part in these types of boards.
Mayor.
Mr. Rodriguez?
You know, I agree with your statement. But it's not customary that mayors are there. I just want to add, one of the things is that it's a big responsibility. You know, I'll be the first one to vote yes on it. If you could just answer me three questions, you know, what funding category do we apply for? On top of that, what is the, what does the category fund? And the third one would be, what plan do we use on the MTP? Those are questions that we were already doing for the last two meetings. You know, it's not about, I don't believe that it's about because we wanna rub shoulders with other mayors and it's customary. It's something that, you know, it wasn't an easy task for me to sit there. You know, when I got on board 4 years ago, Mayor Reese was sitting at the TPP board. And I understand, but I went to every meeting he went. You know, I took classes, excuse me, I'll have the floor. You know, I mean, if you answer me those questions, I'll be the first one to say yes, you know, it's okay. But I mean, it's a situation right now where the TxDOT and El Paso are trying to get away and trying to, you know, strip us of our funding. You know, our director from the MPO stepping down. I mean, you know, it's in limbo right now. You know, if you think you can take the duties, by all means, you know. But I mean, if you can answer me those three questions, I'll be more than happy to step down.
Mr. Duran?
I went to one of the trainings at the MPO, and it was stated then that to be on the MPO, all the mayor had to do was submit a letter. I agree with Mr. Rodriguez has taken the job and done a good job. But we need to pass the torch. And I think that he should help the mayor fulfill the duties at the MPO and of the Transportation Policy Board. I don't like using the acronyms because I get all crazy with them because there's so many of them. And at that meeting, everybody uses the acronyms. But I think that as leader of our city, she needs to lead at the MPO and at other boards, and I would hope that Mr. Rodriguez would help her do these type of things, bring her up to speed as to what's going on, and that way we can move forward.
Ms. Villalobos?
So there, you can only have one appointee from every, you can't have two. Two of them cannot attend just because?
Anybody can attend, but you can just have one voting member. So if all of us would like to attend, all of us can attend.
Okay. And then, Mr. Duran, you said that you went to a meeting where they specifically said that it has to be a mayor?
No.
No?
Oh, no, I went to a training.
To a training.
And I also attended a meeting. Mm-hmm. And the gentleman there said that we don't need to The mayor just needs to submit a letter stating that she will be the new voting member of the MPO. But I think this item is for the Transportation Policy Board.
And who is this member?
I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Excuse me, what was the question?
No. No, no, I'm just saying, who is the member? Because all I'm saying is, if you guys want to remove me, remove me. And that's it. The mayor, Ms. Rodriguez, understood that she could not hold the duties because it was too much. Like I said, I didn't sit on this board till 2 years ago, and that's because Ms. Rodriguez did not want it because she did not understand. She could not catch up. It took me, like I said, took me a year and a half going to every single meeting, going to every single, I had Mr. Medina, and I had Mayor Pridham would go with her, and she would start showing me what I needed to do. I mean, in a blink of an eye, you lose funding. Just last week on Friday when we had the TBV board, you know, Bob Beadick from TxDOT wanted to strip us from $3.6 million. You know, I mean, you need somebody that understands. I mean, not every time is it up for us. I mean, they can say, oh, the tip, you know, CMAQ, you know, but you need to understand that just because there's funding doesn't mean that it's funding for us, for our application. You need to understand when and how you're going to be doing this. I could show Mayor, but I can't show her in a month or two. Like I said, it took me 2 years. Maybe she can grasp it in 6 months from now. But it's crucial moment right now. That's why I feel that it's not the proper time. I will show her if she goes. The last two meetings she wasn't there. Just to sit down next week and or next month to do this, I think it's too soon. I would gladly take her under my wing, show her the ropes, make her understand what funding categories there is. You know, I will do all of that. And when she's ready, I'll be the first one to come and say, hey, it's your turn. Because I do believe that the mayor should. But not all entities understand. For example, take a look at Horizon. The only reason why Walter Miller is still there in the TPB board is because they all understand. You can call Councilman Duran and stuff. You can call the mayor as well and say, hey, why didn't you? Because that's the first thing I asked. They told me, look, institutional knowledge is something you cannot grasp so quick. You know, that's why they have all of these projects that they've gotten and received, because he has a lot of institutional knowledge. I'm not claiming to be the smartest. I'm just saying that I think that she should go. I will take her under my wing, show her, and when you're ready, I'll be the first one to step down. I move for the question.
Ms. Villalobos?
I just want council to know we are at a crucial time with the MPO, and we just need to be very careful. I think his suggestion is a good suggestion, and quite frankly, I'm not understanding why we're here voting. It maybe was as a courtesy, which is very appreciative, but if it's just a matter of sending a letter. But I think his suggestion is a very good suggestion. Attend the meetings. You know, it might be something that's overwhelming. You are the mayor of the city of Socorro, a place that has a lot of needs. You might find, I went to a couple of them and I was overwhelmed. You might, you know, realize that it's too much, and maybe the representative that's there now representing the city of Socorro would be best, so you can serve in other places. That's my suggestion. Thank you.
Mr. Perez?
Certainly, as mayor, you have that for your prerogative to do what you feel is right for the city. I would suggest, and because I know that you're very capable of learning, and Mr. Rodriguez has done an admirable job in representing the city. I think that if we can come to a compromise, that in the next 2 months, just so that you get your feet wet, because I understand. I understand that you need to take your rightful place as part of that board. But also, institutional knowledge can be transferred. And so I think that in a month, if you can bring up the mayor to speed, I think that we can address this issue. And I think it would be have a favorable outcome. Again, it's not an indictment on you or a pejorative on you. You're very capable of learning. I just think that to come in not knowing the acronyms, or maybe you do, I don't know. But if it were me, I think I'd like to attend and then get the institution launch from Mr. Rodriguez, but with the understanding that his role will be ending in that situation. That's fine.
And I have attended the trainings with the director. It's required 6 hours a year, so I've already started on that. And I wouldn't mind if Mr. Rodriguez can continue attending the meetings or any of anybody else in the council. I would just like to go ahead and be part of the board. And I am doing this as a courtesy because all we needed was a letter, but I'm not trying to end Mr. Rodriguez's involvement. You know, I'm just letting him know that I am more than willing to take his help. And if he would like to attend the meetings with me, I would appreciate it.
I think we need to agree with you. I think that we need to keep the primary objective that we have, mm-hmm. is to move the city forward. And,
correct.
Irrespective of who serves, we still need representation. So that's my last 2 cents.
And you do need the government body's approval to send that letter to the MPO. It does have to go through a vote.
And because you voted to send the letter to. So it's not just a letter. Just want to throw that out there too. I'm going to call for the question.
So the motion is to approve. René Rodriguez?
No.
Cesar Nevarez?
To approve the training.
No, but not the training. No. Approve to remove René?
To remove me. Yes.
Victor Perez?
Yes.
Ivan Colombia.
I don't think it's the right thing to do. I think we should have taken the steps we discussed, and I, quite frankly, you know, it's a huge responsibility. For that reason, I say no.
Item number 29, discussion and action to appoint 2 council members to the Socorro Public Finance or Investment Board per Ordinance 321, Section 7, and Ordinance 250, Amendment 1. We need to decide who's going to be.
With all due respect, I'd like to be one of those.
I believe that mayor should be as well.
So I'll make a motion to have Mrs. Villalobos and Mayor Garcia as part of the public finance board,
investment board
for the city of Socorro.
Second. René Rodriguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia.
Yes. Item number 30, discussion and action to create an ad hoc charter committee.
Motion to approve.
Second.
René Rodriguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
Yes. Item number 32, discussion and action to direct the city manager to develop a long-term plan to acquire certain properties on or near Coker Road to construct drainage improvements in the area and to authorize the use of the power of eminent domain for the acquisition.
I'd like to make a motion to approve. to direct city manager to develop a long-term plan to acquire certain properties in near Coker Road. You know, we looked at this before and we took an initiative, but one of the things that I would like to address is that we don't have to necessarily go and take the whole area. We can do a 5 or 6 year plan, and then we can start acquiring properties for the future development of a drainage improvement area for that whole area, not just for a certain individuals. I mean, we need to act on this because this is something that's going to be reoccurring year after year after year. I think that we should start just like El Paso did with theirs underneath the spaghetti bowl. They started incrementally just going here and there. They didn't do it all at once. We could do the same thing. I looked at what they did. I think that we could just direct staff so that they can already start looking into getting appraisals and stuff, and then trying to acquire some of the properties there, so we can already get a head start on a 5 or 6 year plan.
Ms. Yalos?
Couldn't we start small by just not actually acquiring, but bringing back results of what we plan to do and how much it's going to cost? At this point, I know it's a long term, but would it, if we go ahead and vote on this the way it's stated, that gives us the city manager to go ahead and acquire. Do you have a cap? Is there a cap of what you can purchase, or it's open?
No, I would have to bring that to
council. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Alrighty.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Direct to staff.
Just for procedural purposes, I'll second.
Oh.
I just had a question for the attorney. If we're going to go through eminent domain, can we acquire section by section, or does it have to be all at the same time?
You can acquire section by section, provided all okay. The conditions of eminent domain.
But you do have to acquire the whole thing eventually?
You cannot.
You don't?
No.
Okay. Do we have any speakers for this item?
No, we don't.
Okay.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
And Ivan Colombia López?
No.
Item number 33, discussion and action to amend Ordinance 320, Amendment Number 4, Procedures and Rules for City Council Meetings and Agendas, as provided by Section 3.08 of the Socorro City Charter, Paragraph 2, Agenda Development, to remove the second signature to place item on the agenda. Mr. Duran?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Mayor and Council, on this one, if you're going to approve, that needs to direct the city staff or the attorneys to draft an ordinance and then pass it in the first, second reading normal fashion. You can only amend an ordinance to another ordinance. So.
Motion to approve to create an ordinance to, once more time.
To
remove the second signature for putting items on the agenda.
Right, so you don't go through the normal public hearing process. Right?
Okay.
Still second.
René Rodríguez?
No.
Cesar Nevarez?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
I'm sorry, we didn't have a chance to discuss. What was the intent?
Can we discuss? Even though we started voting?
We already started the one.
I just have a question because I haven't pressed my vote, so they would inform my vote.
Yeah.
The purpose is because if when you require a second signature, if you ask a person to be your second, and that person says no, you have to go back to another person. At that time, it's a floating quorum.
It's a quorum only if it's three and the mayor that is notified.
That's what they said at the training.
No.
It has
they
a possibility.
Said we have to follow our charter. And our charter states it's three and the mayor.
Mr. Duran?
Okay, the reason I want this is because, number one, this rule was put in there to exclude council members from putting items on the agenda. We were elected to represent our districts, and if we put something on there because the constituents want it, not because we want it. When we were elected, we did not inherit divine intelligence that tells us what to do right every time. Our constituents are what tells us what to do. And sometimes an item may seem frivolous or dumb to all the council members, but to those constituents, it's very important. So I feel that it was put on there originally to stop people from putting items on the agenda. Plus the fact that when we were at the training, it was said that no, I mean, I think that we were elected to represent our constituents. Whether they want something that rest of council doesn't want, when we bring it up to council, that's the time to decide whether it is going to be passed or not. Not to be shot down because council doesn't want it as a whole. It should be decided in the council meeting. And what happens with if a council member falls out of grace with the other council members, which has happened before, then they are not allowed to put anything on the agenda because nobody will be their second. So who's the one that is damaged by that? Is the constituents, because their items are not being heard by the council as a whole. And we need to, whatever somebody wants to put on, we need to be able to put on without having, and it's a waste of staff's time, because a lot of times I've gotten phone calls, will you be a second? You know, we shouldn't be out there hunting down people for a second just because a while back we didn't want a certain council member to be putting items on the agenda. We need to be able to be held accountable to our constituents. If they want us to put something on the agenda, it's our duty to put it on there, whether other council members agree with it or not, which is the main reason I put it on there, plus the fact that it is it could be a floating quorum. If three voting members listen or are aware of the problem, not in the, it just, that was what we were told in San Antonio, three voting members. And so, but that one to me is irrelevant. We need to be responsible to our constituents, and the only way we can do that is to be able to put on the agenda what they ask for.
Mr. Perez?
So, and I apologize, I can't remember the charter verbatim. So does this impact the charter as far as us not adhering to it?
I haven't looked at whether this would require a charter amendment, but as this is worded, it looks like the only requires an amendment. So that would be an ordinance amendment.
This was not put on the charter. This was an ordinance that they created.
Right.
So, as my motion stated, we're going to create another ordinance to get rid of this ordinance.
Ms. Villalobos?
I was there at the meeting. We did hear it. It was one of my questions. I got up and asked, you know, the question. And yes, I agree. Our constituents should be speaking to us, and we should be trying to do the best that we can for them. And every if they want the item passed through council, they should have that right through their representative or any other representative. So I agree. Thank you.
Mr. Pitts?
Aye.
Ivan Colombia?
Yes.
Item number 34, discussion and action to post city property behind Walgreens legal description block 9, Socorro Grand, track 16, for lease to promote economic development.
Motion to approve for discussion.
Second.
Mr. Lund?
The reason I put this on there is because the land is just sitting there. We can rent it out to farmers who will take care of the weeds, for number one. We won't have that problem anymore. And granted, it's not going to generate a lot of income, but it will generate some income for the city and relieve the staff from having to keep the weeds chopped down and any other thing. I don't know if anybody's going to really want to rent it, but farmers, I know they do rent property for farming, and until we need it, it can be on a year-to-year basis. And when we do need the property for city expansion, then we can just go ahead and take it back.
Ms. Yelvas?
I completely agree with that. Right now, our farmers that are leasing these properties are losing land because we have all these developments coming up. I know of one right next to me that was talking the other day and saying that he's losing his land. He was leasing it, and now they're going to start building homes there, or they're thinking of. And so, therefore, the land is just sitting there. Why not use it for something that could bring in profits and help us with our parks or whatever the case? And again, I agree with him. We don't have to go out there and cut the weeds and keep it clean because somebody else is going to be leasing it from us.
Mr. Perez?
Well, just before we put the cart before the horse, is it still agricultural?
Sure thing.
Because the concern is that if it's not agricultural, well, we can always, I guess, rezone it. Otherwise, we're subject to getting the building that we don't like.
I will send out a court enforcement officer first thing. There, the property is on C2 commercials.
So we'd have to revert it back to, no, we're not going to, I don't think we should lease it for a building. We would have to revert it back to farming.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that's the least of our worries, correct? Or am I being naive?
Well, the thing is that
to convert it back again. Well, it depends on who wants to lease it and for what, no?
Well, I don't think we should lease it for any long term.
Correct. Right, and if I may interject, you're essentially downzoning the property now, essentially removing a lot of land uses that you can potentially use a property for something that's extremely limited what you can use it for. Cultural, so that later, if you do decide we're going to stop leasing it, build something, or actually sell it to somebody who wants to build something commercially, then you have to come back and rezone it to a commercial zoning district.
Well, I think that maybe if we rezone it, I'm sure I didn't ask. If we rezone it, that could be a demonstration site for all of the agricultural things that we've talked about. And so that could be, remember how we talked about the innovative farming, like bees and all those things. You know, that could be a demonstration center.
There are community farms that a lot of cities operate. We did see that where that, you know, if we did turn it back agricultural, we could have a city community farm. Very, you know, innovative, but that's a very good idea.
And we could have a market. It's just discussion right now. If we were to change the zoning and then we wanted to get use out of it, and we've had these at least one presentation about the bees, the medicinal bees, that could be we could include that in other innovative farming products and use that as a demonstration site and turn it into use it as a market. Weekend market.
Market will not be allowed under
A1.
A
market? No?
No, sir.
Okay. Scratch that. But either way, we can still use it for other things. Mike?
I think that agriculture would be the best bet because that is a year-to-year lease. And that way, when if we ever decide to build a new city hall or whatever we decide to do with it, it won't be that big of a deal to just terminate the lease. Whereas if you rent it as commercial and they build a building on there, then we're kind of...
5 years.
We're stuck.
10 years.
Yeah, this way we can, as Mr. Perez said, we can use it as a, you know, kind of a community farm.
But we can't?
Yes, we can. Yes, we'll have to rezone it first, of course. Do we have to pay the fee, the city?
I'd have to get a approval from administration for that, sir.
That's something to think about.
Yeah, but we do, though.
Essentially,
would that be
yes,
zoning?
Identify interested parties.
Yeah.
Let's find the buyer or the
renter.
The tenant. And then we need the
Ms. Yellows?
Okay. So that was my suggestion. Can't we just approve tonight that we could do A, B, C, or D? And put a price? Or do we just vote on it now and then come back and A would be this, B, we could allow A, B, and C. And this is how much, this is what we'll allow. So we're not going back and forth?
Well, this right now, we will approve to lease all and then have staff look into it and give you back some options.
Mm-hmm.
You know, kind of let you know how we're gonna market it, how we what interest we have. Do you have a potential tenant?
No.
Yeah.
Do we have other land?
Sorry?
Do we have other land that we can do this to?
If we do own a couple of others, we can write some item on the agenda to provide you with inventory of the space.
Do I need to amend my motion?
Your motion wants to approve?
Yes.
I think if you approve, let's post your approving question for these with its current use.
Okay. Yeah.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
Yes.
César Nevares?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
Iván Colombia Villalobos?
Yes.
Do we have anything for 39, 40, and 41? Motion to delete?
Motion made to delete items 39 through 41.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
César Nevares?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
Iván Colombia Villalobos?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
René Rodríguez?
Aye.
César Nevares?
Yes.
Ralph Duran?
Yes.
Victor Perez?
Aye.
Iván Colombia Villalobos?
Yes.
9:20. Meeting is now adjourned.
We adjourn at 9:20.